First of all, we are together with Tim Flack, who is a well-known and famous environmental photographer. And we will see his latest series called Ekus at Ortaköy Kethuda Hamamı. In this historical place, I think your photos will strike attention, Tim. And thank you again to 212 Photography Istanbul team for inviting us for this conversation. My name is Burak and I am working as the executive at Borsan Contemporary. And I am leaving the scene to Tim Flack.
My name is Tim Flack. I'm very honored to be showing my very first project called Equus at 212 Photography Istanbul. What I'd like to share with you today is not only my various bodies of work, worked on a number of bodies of work, which you can see some of the covers here. First Equus, then one on dogs called Dogs Gods, More Than Human and Endangered. And now my most recent book to come out shortly is on birds. A lot of my work is presented in public spaces, as well as in galleries and in many different platforms. Sometimes they're floating in lakes or they're parts of museum shows with quite literally millions of visitors. This is the present show in Kunming, where I think there's 2.4 million visitors to my show. So what I'm interested in and essentially has been the focus of my work has been how to connect people to the storytelling around the natural world. This is the cover of my book, Equus. This is the project that I published in 2008. This is behind the scenes of an image, which is a royal yard in Ajman. And what you see is myself using lights to slightly offset the natural light outside to create what is a slightly surreal picture, where the idea is the horse almost becomes framed by the stable window. And this is part of this kind of play between a heritage of equine painting. John Stubbs did a picture of a horse very similar in color, and it's playing with that kind of multi-laying viewing. This is a halter horse, which is a show horse. Some of my images are really exploring this question about, you know, you look at this kind of picture and it can look like I'm dealing with some strange, almost fetish ideas, but actually if you know more about horses, you recognize that this is a fly net. And so I think I like this ambiguity in image making, where you're not quite sure what you're looking at, or that different viewers take away different thoughts around imagery. Just as this horse, which is recovering from surgery, has given anesthetic, could look like it's about to enter a boxing ring. And I think this kind of layering and slightly twisting is a very interesting side of photography. Not everything has to be kind of explained. In the same way, you could say that this picture here, it's got a sensuality. It's not really anthropomorphic, but yet it reminds you maybe of feeding a sugar lump to the horse, you know, literally, and thinking of that sensual experience with the horse. In a similar way, connecting back to the mane of a horse, I call this Horse Mountain, because in a way it might remind you of your winter holiday. And yet it was Mies van der Rohe, the architect, that said less is more. At what point do you reduce your subject matter so that it evokes something else, but is still clearly a mane or the neck of a horse? This is behind the scenes of one of the shoots I did in Iceland, and they literally have adapted to this landscape that when a horse leaves, they call them horses, they're the size of ponies, they can't come back into Iceland because they have a blood import ban that's been operational for 700 years. But you get this kind of slightly surreal play, and it's something that I found fascinating. I wanted in this project to put the animals in the historical, or in a sense, the landscape as a document of how they adapted the way they did, because many of the breeds of horses became what they were because of the environments that they worked in or existed. I think it's about midnight here in Iceland in the summer. And this is literally before the storm came in. A minute later, I was drenched. They call this withering, when the horses nibble each other's withers as forms of affection. Haflingers from Austria on the lower parts of the Alps. Again, I like that play between the horses adopting, almost echoing something of the landscape. They become a part of it. Some of my images, I wanted to explore that sort of perspective, so you might see a horse galloping away, but one thing that photography does so brilliantly is it fragments a moment in time. It allows you to extend an experience of something that would happen that you couldn't argue persistence of vision denies you in actuality. But as a picture, you can be there. Now, I set up a treadmill here so that the animal could be at full gallop, but I could literally be right in there behind it, offering a perspective to someone perhaps who spends every day with horses, but allow them an extension of their experiences around the subject. Or they may not be mad enough to spend time literally behind the hooves of a galloping horse. Also, it's that sensuality. I mean, these could be two bodies, quite literally, but they're horses. They almost evoke a sense of an anthropomorphic form, but they allow us to observe the beauty of the equine line. And this is something, again, I wanted to keep exploring in this book project. All the different, keep pulling through different ideas and thoughts. Again, the neck form, denying the face of the horse, but allowing the neck and the twists and the muscle form to reveal themselves. This is an eye of a blind horse. You might say, well, that's a bit strange to do that. But I felt that almost the blind eye became like a globe, like a sphere. And this leads me to an actual horse embryo shot that I did at day 10. So what had happened is they were moving embryo from a biological mother to a surrogate mother. And I was in a Petri dish with embryonic fluid for literally about five, it gave me about a few minutes to photograph it. So this is the very beginning of the life form, and then I photographed it as it evolved. So this is day 90. So there you get this almost sense of a smiling animal. It's slightly unnerving because you don't know quite what you're looking at. The eyes become almost like models, like lines. They haven't opened up yet. They have almost a plasticity about them. And there's a slight uncertainty. And definitely there's a type of ambiguity. And I think that ambiguity is a very important aspect of the photographic medium. What I mean by that is that it can have multiple meanings, which are determined by all of our unique, you could argue, journeys in life that make for different meanings that we take away. There may be some things that we share, but we have to accept that when we put an image out there, it will come back with many different thoughts. For somebody who maybe, you know, has a certain experience in life, this might be a disturbing picture, reminding themselves of some event they don't want to be reminded of. This was an image that today might be easier, but when I did the image, what I did is set up a studio light on a vehicle, and in tandem, we went down a track, and I photographed it from my window with a Hasselblad, and then ahead of me was a truck with two studio lights, and so the horse is in full gallop, but I wanted to create a slightly stylized view of it, almost painterly, by approaching it this way. You could only get a couple of runs and then it's all kind of over. This is in the States, the Mustangs, feral horses roaming around. And what you see here is you see the sort of, at the very front, you have is the lead mare. And then each horse in hierarchy has its foal following with its mother. And at the back, you have the stallion watching out that no one else comes and grabs any of his the other horses.
Tim, I would like to stop you at this point. I do like this picture. I've been studying your book for over and over again. And this reminds me the thing that, like, thousands of years ago, the people did cave paintings inside the caves or on the bones that can be found, the drawings of horses. Did you think about it while taking this picture?
Not specifically this picture, but one thing I did do, and I featured in the book, was a Paleolithic art, because I was interested in the whole connection with horses and us, and how pre-equitation, that is when we actually domesticated the horse, how the horse still played a very big part in our imagination. And so the graphicness of those horses that represented a kind of spiritual dimension, there was a piece of bone that I featured in the book at the beginning that showed horses drawn onto the rib bone of a horse. And it was dated about 15,000 years ago, Middle Paleolithic period. But I wanted to make clear that we also hunted the horse initially for food. And then, of course, later on, it became this very unique relationship. So you can't really separate the horse from our cultural heritage, whether that is the way we use language, like we say we're tethered to something, whether we say how many horsepower something has. There's so many elements of our language, which is actually shaped by this extraordinary association we had with the horse. And if you go back to a sense, because the horse accompanied us in different way, in different respects, through the very, you know, for the very beginning of humanity.
Yeah, you were just saying something quite important also. I mean, this relationship brings the hierarchy as well. And you mentioned the hierarchy in this line. There is the leader of the group and the rest is following the leader. Also, we are building up the relationship in this hierarchical way. I mean, we are riding them like two photographs before. I think you're showing this, the full gallop we're seeing at the back of the horseshoes. That's quite interesting. I mean, You are showing this relationship while breaking this hierarchy as well, I think.
I think that my choice of the project was to try and separate the presence of humans. But of course, their presence is expressed by, for example, the mask that I showed earlier and the function. But in another way, I wanted to, in the majority of my images, to celebrate the form of the horse and not necessarily with bridle or tack, as we might say. That, in fact, I wanted to celebrate it. But when you talk about hierarchy, obviously, if you look at the horse historically, you'll see that there was documentation in our culture and our art that expressed this unique relationship with the horse, independent of those cultures mixing. So you had it all around the world in cave paintings and whatever, this unique relationship with the horse expressed, a bit like the good and the bad. You always have, you know, in certain, you know, this idea of good mounted on a horse, man, and crushing the evil, whether it's a dragon or some force. The horse is the mount that mounts us, and that represents, symbolizes good, and then it's crushing what is bad, because the horse is, in a sense, become our partner, our mount, essentially.
Yeah, that's true.
So this is behind the scenes in Iceland. These are fumaroles, which are natural gases, sulfur gases coming out of the ground. And at the time, I think I was quite interested in using them almost as a metaphor. So the one at the back looks a bit like a chimney pot, but actually it's nature oozing out the smoke. And they become almost laden, like they're pulling along something. I mean, I'm reading a lot into this, but I think images work a bit like this. You look at them and this is slightly surreal. It looks like smoke or something, but actually it's fumaroles, which are natural sulfur gases emerging out of the ground in Iceland. I wanted to share a few behind the scenes. Very early on, I tried using flash outside. Today, I probably wouldn't even do that now because the speed of cameras is so improved. I'd probably just use natural light with autofocus. For me, this was a kind of cliche, but it's this sort of idea of almost the symbol of a horse rearing up. I also managed to get the local diving instructor in the Emirates to come and keep me on the side of a tank from floating in the middle of this training tank where they train them through the water, often when they're recovering from injury. And one of those shots, you can actually see that they've patched up or bandaged up one of the hooves, and they're actually using this to recondition the horse, to allow it to get strength back. I also like the slightly abstract form of it.
What I find quite interesting in these two pictures is that we care so much about horses that we do take care of them. I mean, at the beginning, you show the masks to prevent flies or to prevent any damage after surgery. We do invest in horses, right?
Well, of course, if you think about it, that we use horses as a way to gain power. So today it might be a stealth bomber, but in those days it was developing a horse that was that bit had more endurance, or it might have been that, you know, warfare, the outcome of it was determined by the ability to design a stirrup that could be used. So there was a real actuality to that. Also, it was often a way of controlling, you know, the squire or the person who controlled, whether he was a sheikh, would often have the unique right to decide what bloodlines of the best horses were given to who. So this is also deeply rooted in authority. You know, in our country, if you were a peasant, you weren't allowed to ride a horse. You might better use a bullock and possibly a horse in the field for plow, but you weren't, you know, there was a control. So you talk about the order of the horses. Well, of course, you go back and it had a different role. Today, we enjoy horses for pleasure. It's still, you know, the sports of kings. But what I think is important to emphasize is that although we don't think of horses, we have a much more sentimental approach to horses because they're for our pleasure to escape our busy work lives and get into the country and ride away. They were put down mines. They were used a bit like you might use a car. They were, you know, they were exploited for things, you know, to move bricks, to do whatever. And that, you know, we have a different approach, but also perhaps 100 years ago, we would have been able to read where their ears were looking, where, what they were indicating, whether they were upset or happy or whatever, because we could read the language of the horse better because it was more important. Just like someone might know about how many vowels or how many liters a car is or how, you know, it's characteristic, then they might have been thinking about what this horse represented. They'd look at it and know that's got good conformation for endurance. for example. So in a way, we have both moved away from the horse in one respect. We moved towards the horse as something that we embrace with a certain sentiment and care. You know, ethical values towards how we treat horses has greatly changed. Just as it might be for the dog that accompanies in your home. It's called the companion dog because it eats at the table with you. In the past, it might not allow it to be in the house. It might have been chained up to be a guard dog, to be a working dog. We have changed our relationships with animals a great deal. And obviously, it's difficult to think how someone might have thought 100 or 100, 200 years ago.
Thank you very much, because I already received another answer for another question of mine. Thank you.
You're welcome. This was actually done on a cloudy day, and I asked a very famous jockey to jump over my camera. I didn't, by the way, I did it remotely because I thought, for one, I don't want to get hit by the horse, but also it probably would have spooked the horse as well. Because horses are very mindful of people, you know, they'll try to avoid them. But I like this idea of being absolutely underneath the horse, so you're not these slightly to the side.
That shoot is also quite interesting to me because, I mean, as I said before, we're riding the horse and we usually see them from above, not from below, or also maybe we just interact with them on our eye level. But I want to point out that I think you received a painting education, right? If I'm not wrong.
Yes, I mean, I think for all of us, obviously our journeys in life determine how we work. And my background was that I've always been interested in fine art rather than photographers. I also have definitely been informed by that background. I trained as a painter, but also I find to this day, I look towards artists to gain understanding. I believe that, you know, art's been around for thousands of years, or the legacy of that, whereas photography is a relatively new medium. And so that's absolutely true. And I think that that's not to say that I don't respect or look to my contemporaries in photography, merely that I feel there's a long history to be from the painting tradition, but also we have tools today like Photoshop that allow us to use photography almost like painters did in the past, to redirect the eye, to manage the edges and the form, to in a sense allow us to connect with those things we get excited about when we take a picture.
Yeah, I wanted to ask this because this photograph is more look like an abstract painting. I mean, the horse mountain and also the close-ups of the body shapes of the horses are also incredible. However, this one is more like quite abstract. I mean, this is not what we are expecting to see.
I think that when you take pictures, if people ask me, you know, I take a lot of pictures now in the studio because I want to look at the character and personality of animals, which I'll enter into later. But if everyone was doing that in the studio, then I'd probably be out looking for animals in the jungle. I think there's an importance of the relationship of how things are experienced, if things are familiar. If you have, you know, there's something compelling about the unfamiliar, and yet sometimes you want to bring the unfamiliar with the familiar. That sounds a bit, but they're just twisting those realities. It's just allowed us to rethink and readdress what we're looking at. Maybe you relook at the anatomical structure of the horse because it is so graphic and it does present it not slightly off to the side, which you might see going over a jump normally. And then I think this is the fun of the medium, to both, in a sense, arrest that moment, fragment a moment that extends and allows you to examine it, whereas you couldn't do that in reality. And that may be still an argument why the medium of still photography still has a place, even though we have moving image. So I wanted to bring myself to something that might surprise you guys, but I wanted to talk about some of the theories in my work.
And that's great.
Decide whether you want to include this or not include it. So this is, some of it's quite new. I'm working with social scientists and neuroscientists and other people looking at, you know, how do we depict animals so that we can evoke empathy that could lead to conservation support? Obviously, we are at a time when it's never been more important to connect people to nature, to understand the stories, and in a sense connect, maybe you could argue the egotists as well, to stories that are going to fundamentally determine humanity's future. So going to the mechanisms of perception, I would put to you, what do you think you're looking at here? And I would say that this here looks like an look like eyes. And we can't help ourselves but think we're looking at eyes because we're wired that way. But actually, it's the back of the ears here from behind of the pig. But we can't help it. In the same way, we can't but help ourselves look at these gills here and imagine that they're eyes. And this is something we're propelled to want to do. It's the first thing we do. And so they're actually gills. And this smiley mouth is, you know, a mouse still. So this brings me to how we look at images. So I would say, look at this picture of a Hungarian pulley, and it looks quite symmetrical. And I doubt many of you would disagree with that. If I flip it, it's no longer symmetrical. Now, the reason, the one I'm going to really want to explore is, why is that? And there is reasons. By the way, the head is here. I was tempted to put a pole on that, but you know.
It looks like a mop, actually.
That doesn't it? I was going to put the pole there, but I didn't in the end. So look at this picture of the panda, and I'm going to tell you what I think you might see. So
is it lying?
This is
lying on the ground?
If I said to you that there was a window in the top right-hand corner, I'm guessing that you didn't see it very quickly.
No.
And I can predict that most people would not see it. And the reason you don't see it is we naturally go one side of a picture and around, and that we naturally go from left to right. And that was the reason that the dog looked symmetrical one way, but not the other. We shape things according to the way we see them. This has quite important implications. So here we have a dog. It's done a misty morning, part of my project called Dogs Gods. I released about 30 pheasants and they all went mostly in the wrong direction. And you go up here and you come back round. This is classical composition, but none of you got to here probably. If any of you found it, I'd be surprised. You will find it a bit later.
Exactly. I managed it, but like 10 seconds later.
Exactly. Because what you do is look there and you start, and also you're suspicious because I'm just showing you a picture when I've just showed you another one with something you missed. So, but my point being is we naturally look one way. And this is because this is a thermal imaging showing essentially what shows this red spot shows where we predominantly look to one side of a face. It's for facial recognition. The right hemisphere of the brain switches us to camera right on the human face or left. So if we take this forward, that's why this image, which looked symmetrical, now looks not symmetrical. So going forward, this is an image from my current book, Birds, which comes out next month, or no, actually November, first week of November. This is daylight. I can't control anything. So what I've done in the post-production is decided I want to shoot you to the eye. I don't want you up here, and I want to move you back around here. So that's the retouch. And the retouch will create luminosity because the way I'm using counter shading, which is a technique the painters use to create chiaroscuro and lights and darks. In the same way, this gorilla shot, which I did in Gabon, literally from a river, I decided I want to pull the eye up here. So I added the droplet of water. What this does is it pulls you up one side and round. The outcome of that is subtle, but it allows it to become more emotive. Charged into the areas of interest, even if it's the socket of an eye, it changes the way you engage. So moving on to one of my other projects, but after this is a project called More Than Human. You might look at that and get a bit worried that I've got a chicken that's got no feathers on. This is actually a naturally occurring chicken. I have not, or cockerel, I've not plucked it, I promise you. It's naturally occurring like a sphinx cat is. But it's interesting because it brings us to this question about how we know animals. Today, we're more likely to see a chicken or whatever headless in cellophane in the supermarket. Not many of us keep hen-laying chickens or boiler chickens, that is, for eating. And there we are. We have this almost anthropomorphic ballerina on point going across a stage. And it's this sort of ambiguity that I think is interesting. It's not something you probably want to put in your bedroom. It's not a picture you want to, it might be disturbing, but it does bring to the question how we know animals, because this is how we know them. They just don't look back at you. You know, we see them without feathers most of the time. In the same way, this bat, you know, it looks like something from Phantom of the Opera. It looks like something with a cloak like this looking at you. It's got the drama. You gauge with it with personality and character. We call it opera bat. In the same way, these guys look some like Egyptian mummies looking back at you. Or there's this compassion. You know, you feel that this other bat's looking after the other bat. And here you feel one bat's giving the other one a bit of earache. It could be. So what's happening is there's a sort of drama of gestations that lead to a narrative. But if you think about it, you haven't tried to turn them. I've turned them upside down, but we engage with them because this is what we're used to, the eyes being above the feet. So we become habitual viewers. We can be predictably following a route because you can sense that we think normally eyes are not below the feet. In the same way earlier, we were looking at images because we, in a sense, have a tendency to go one way around the frame. So in the same way, this tiger shaking is a tiger shaking. It has at one level, I think, familiarity. You think of a golden retriever or a dog shaking water off, that's familiar. Tiger's not familiar, but we slip between our sense that we know that kind of thing, but we don't know it. And the saliva becomes a visceral thing that leads us through the frame and around.
I want to ask you a question at this point. First, how did you take the photographs of those bats? I mean, if you use flash, probably they will be disturbed, but...
They're sort of fruit bats. They're most active at twilight. And they're, so they're not totally... Well, they have some sight, poor sight. And so they're not too disturbed. We just make sure the flash wasn't strong. For example, vampire bats, because of their feeding habit of feeding off blood, they have to be, there aren't many species of them, by the way. There are very few vampire species, but they have to work in total darkness because they obviously want to extract the blood from their hosts without them knowing that they're there. So this is, I'm in one of these suits. This is a reintroduction program to do with a panda. And actually, this is the first stage of a reintroduction program where they're weighing panda, but they don't want to look like a human. I don't think they're trying to look like pandas either. They just don't want the panda cub, when it grows up and released into the wild, thinking humans' food, I must come out to them. So this is a way of, you don't want to imprint them with the human form. So this one looks like it's doing karaoke, and that's very ambiguous. And I think it's intriguing because it leaves you again in this rather strange space. You're being looked at, you're being gazed at, you know, and you can't but help, you're propelled to gaze back. And one of the things that I'm exploring at the moment, and I'm working with social scientists that have shown evidence that if you create these portraits, which are a bit like human portraits, they're anthropomorphic, but they call it critical anthropomorphism, where the aim is to push storytelling that is pro-environmental outcome, you know, for conservation support, then it may be a vital element to conservation communication. This axolotl is an amazing creature. It can regrow back parts of its brains, its limbs, and it's from Mexico, a salamander to be precise.
You usually take photos with a blank background. Is this something specific? I mean, it must be because we do engage with the animals, what we are seeing in this quite human level. I mean, the environment photographers are usually include the environment as well.
Yeah.
But we rarely see it in your photos.
Yeah, and this is for a very good reason. And it's actually backed up with research that I recently been involved with. Eames said when a lot of the environmental movement, they believed in romanticizing nature, would inevitably lead for us to care more about it. But the evidence of the research I did with these social scientists in America, where we had thousands of subjects to test this, we found that actually when they looked at no images or looked at images that were traditional wildlife images where the landscape was, you know, an integral part of the picture, there was no more empathy towards the subject. Whereas images that were like mine, quite anthropomorphic, had increased anxiety, might sound a problem, but increasing in empathy. And empathy leads to conservation support. So the argument could be that you need this attention-grabbing moment to get people to engage with the story, and that the traditional wildlife may be the way to, after that, to effectively educate them into the environmental story in a more direct way. But once you have something that's over there in a wild, free, non-human world, it's a distant non-human world, it's much harder for us to care about things. And one of the things that really, if you look at the history of photography, some of the most powerful pictures that were to change the course of war, whatever, were pictures that made that little bit of a switch into our world. I give an example. During the Syrian crisis, there were a lot of boats washed up and deaths on the Italian border. There's one picture of a five-year-old child being held by a paramilitary policeman. Why did that picture change overnight the approach of Merkel in Germany to allowing more Syrian refugees into the country? And here in the UK with Cameron, our prime minister, was because the picture showed 2 feet hanging down with Velcro shoes. And if you're a parent, you can connect to the vulnerability of your own child. Mm-hmm. Until a picture comes from that sense of otherness to sameness, does it have that touches the hearts and minds of us? One of the things we have to understand is we are human. We anthropocentrize, that is, we understand the world from us outwards. And if we're to communicate, there is a need for anthropomorphism, but use as in with intention to make us care about things so that we want to take action and understand if the action is merely to engage with the storytelling of the prominent debates that are out there at a time when we have never been more, in a sense, separated from the natural world. It is more important that mediums like photography have, well, the medium photography, I'd argue, has a very important role more than ever before. Not because it's the most, been more democratized medium and that we have more social platforms, we look at more content, but because we're also more separated from the natural world at a time when we need to connect with those stories. And the scientists who have the information, that needs to be translated into the popular space so that people can get it and those who are the influencers can change policies because they understand what the stories are. So here we have a very anthropomorphic type shot of a crown at macaque, curiosity looking over the edge. And here I've used almost compositional devices. Again, you can see my use of entering the picture around the composition that a painter might have used, or the intimate moment of what probably is a dominant situation, one bonobo dominating another. A bonobo is like a chimp, but they also share very close DNA with us. And that you have here something that looks like a loving gesture.
Yeah.
You have to equate it in human terms, not in terms of understanding animal behavior. And here, this guy, one of the rarest primates in the world, Pytamerum, comes from South America, from the capital of the Amazon, Manaus. It's been concreted out to extinction, yet we're familiar with it. Why are we familiar with it? Because the science fiction character Yoda from Star Wars is modeled on him. But this animal can slip into oblivion, yet we're still left with the science fiction character of Yoda from Star Wars.
That's quite interesting because I've been thinking that I was thinking that this animal was similar to something else, but I couldn't name the Yoda.
Yeah, so the way we work with images, we have this slippage, you know, between different experiences. What I'm getting at, like the tiger is a tiger shaking, but the tiger's also reminiscent of your dog that might have gone in the water and shaken off the water. We start this slippage, we move between different thoughts. And I think that was why I said photography is ambiguous, that it can have multiple meanings. Not that it's unclear, but it can have multiple layers. And what, as a visual communicator, I'm fascinated in how people transform things into meaning. And by doing that, I don't mean the meaning can be absolute, but that I'm almost interested in its potentiality for meaning and what those meanings and how they move around. If you're a photographer, you must be all mindful of what context is, because context can change everything. And it's that, you know, pictures are not, it is, I believe that they can be used with the right storytelling, but as we must respect the fact that it's the overall experience of all the elements that add up to what we get from something. This looks like it's had extreme cosmetic surgery. It's a snow-nosed monkey, specially adapted nose for very, very cold climates. And this is one of the rarest critically endangered species called a saiga. Comes from the coast of, I've shot this in Russia near the Caspian Sea, and it's one of the most endangered and can't be kept in captivity. It's hunted for its horns, and it looks something like a remnant of the Ice Age. It's an antelope that's adapted this nose so it can feed on the ground in very dusty, open, we call them the steppes, the open grasslands. And this obviously is a cliche, but that's why this shows the landscape. What point you need to do, I believe, is connect us emotionally with the animal, get right in there and show that character. It's the juxtaposition of these that's so important. You know, I look at this animal. When I photographed this animal, I knew its story. I'd gone there to photograph the last male northern rhino.
Is this Sudan?
Yes, it is Sudan. And so called Sudan because they came from Sudan, this deceased species, and it was actually being looked after in Kenya. But I was mindful that I was looking at the last of its species, or male of its species. There are two females now alive. This one died some years ago. But the fact that, you know, you question, well, how did it get to that place? And it's a reminder of, you know, in a sense, a document of how when we know something's slipping into oblivion or into extinction, that we can't necessarily pull it back. I believe if we can use mise-en-scène photography to make people truly care, that we can bring back animals from the edge of extinction. But we have to feel it in our hearts. And that's the way the arts can help the sciences, by bringing emotion and empathy to allow us to start connect with the storytelling. Because there is great science out there, but certain biologists have said that you can have the best science in the world, but less emotion is involved, it's a bit irrelevant. Here's another one from the, this is Tsavo National Park in Kenya. Again, I want to be right in there. I want you to go, whoa, there's a character with a hippo. These are butterflies migrating 4,000 miles from the borders of Canada right down to Mexico to winter there.
It's quite interesting. I mean, butterflies are usually known as being fragile creatures, but they migrate like 4,000 kilometers.
Yeah, they do it down on the airstreams and they cluster and they live. These live for about 9 months. Some butterflies only a few days. But it's quite extraordinary that they go there and then they will migrate through generations up to Canada and then they'll come down the airstreams in one generation and stay and winter and then they go back up. Here we have fireflies that flash in the forest.
It's often like a scene from Avatar.
Yes, absolutely. And that brings me really to the question that we use bioluminescence as a metaphor for Mother Nature, for the spirit, the soul. In fact, the Japanese, where I took this picture in southern Japan, referred to these as the dancing souls. And they're literally flashing. And this is a one-hour time exposure taken from the last light. And what you see is literally the trace of these fireflies. In the same way, you're looking at, these are called sea angels. They're basically sea slugs. But the plankton becomes a celestial world. It becomes something that almost evokes a cathedral with the cupids or whatever. But they become these, they play on our imagination, but they're basically sea slugs of Japan. This brings me to my last thing. So this book is my book on birds, and I've been working on it for 3 years. I'm going to swing you around on my camera. You'll see all bits of small bits there, and I think over here. And this is essentially linked to my new book, which I spent 3 years working on. And it's really just celebrating the forms of different birds. So I'm just going to bring you through a few of those. These are from Australia, the cockatoos look like they're in discussion. I made a small set with water in the studio for these ducks. And that led me to thinking, cool, why don't I do this on a larger scale? So I knew somebody had some flamingos. So I built this, and this is the film background to me building a set for the flamingos. So we put down some black plastic. I lit very side on so that the black didn't get overlit. And this allowed me, you know, I love the water reflection. So there's something about the almost painterly quality. We talked about the painting influence in that. And this is the outcome of it. So you get this almost, they become like snake-like forms, the flamingos. Mm. But they're also something I don't believe has been done quite like this. Or no one's mad enough to do it, maybe. That's probably what it is. Cuban flamingos, or they're known sometimes as American flamingos. So you get these wonderful, I love these abstractions and twists and turns. They've got beaks, by the way.
It's mesmerizing.
They've got beaks that are designed specifically to feed upside down, and they feed in very shallow water. So they're the only ones who can swallow. Both the mandibles move, and that's sort of, you might say, morphologically unique within the birds. And these guys was actually a case of the lockdown, because I couldn't get to a lot of places, but the local aquarium from Sea Life in London had basically got no public. So a friend of mine who works there said, oh, you can come on photograph our penguins. So I managed to throw a bit of, basically like prawns, they're called krill, which is what they live off in the wild. And these guys are literally diving in like torpedoes. And the funny story is that we have a very, I don't know what your speed limit is, but ours is only 20 miles an hour. I don't know how many kilometers that is. But these guys can swim 22 miles an hour. So that if they were outside in the road, I'd get a speeding ticket if I went as fast as these guys. They're the fastest animals underwater, faster than penguins. But you can see they're torpedo-like. You can see the incredible evolution. And how evolution has evolved these guys to be what they are. And these
how
are
did,
like...
How did you take that photo? I mean, that fast, how did you capture it?
Well, firstly, these are poultry and they were bred by us. And funny enough, Darwin kept these. And it was partly the keeping of them and the understanding that poultry could be shaped so much by us, by selective breeding. That was one of the catalysts for his formulating the theory of evolution and the publication of his book, of The Origin of Species, because he kept these. He was obsessed by pigeons. But these are Jacobean pigeons named after the Jacobean monks. But they are actually how we bred them to look. They do look like one of them looks like it's got a sort of fur coat on. And this is behind the scenes. I've got an aviary here and sometimes a turntable. And sometimes I do it so the bird can't see me. But I wanted these direct portraits showing birds that you wouldn't normally see that way. This is a Tocotuca or Virginia cardinal from North America. An Inca tern from Peru, handlebar moustache, apparently tells the potential mates that I'm healthy. The bigger the moustache, the healthier the bird is, the more attractive apparently they are. But don't they make a weird character? And here's another shot from Sidon of a military macaw, an endangered species. And this is final image I'm showing you today is a hyacinth macaw. I love that kind of almost symbolism as it flies away. So that is my last image, and that's the book that will be out literally very shortly.
All of your works are quite amazing, and I cannot stop asking myself questions. How did he took these photographs and stuff? I'd really wonder that, how do you work with these animals in your studio? Do you set up new studios at the farms where you can transport these animals into the studio easily, or are there anything specific that you are doing?
I think it's an interesting question. I mean, you're absolutely right. I suppose it's probably better to say, what am I trying to do with the images and then looking at the situation? So sometimes I have controllability, like this bird that's showing here, which is the Virginia cardinal, very small bird. It probably only represents this space. Small guy that you wouldn't normally see if you're watching it feed on your bird table. You'd be in North America, by the way. But if you were, that's what you would barely be able to examine the detail. So this is the aviary I showed a couple back, I think it was, here. But for many of the birds, I can't bring them into an aviary. They'd be too spooked. They're not used to people. So I would hide with 800mm lens and maybe just use natural light. So the one I mentioned to you earlier with the moustache, yep, is natural light. So I use flash, which is bronze color, which is high speed. But your question really was, what kind of setups do I have? Well, I probably question what's the situation with the animal. So sometimes I'm in the wild, sometimes I'm in an open aviary where I'm hiding literally behind something so the bird can't see me. Sometimes with a parrot, they're so used to humans that you can literally manage them and move them around. Situations really, you kind of work around the nature of the animal. You have to understand the animal by asking questions to the owner as to what they're used to. But some of the species I did for the book are not used to seeing people, and they're not like a bird of prey that will just happily perch for you in front of the camera. But I wanted to explore all the different forms of birds and then organize them almost in the evolutionary sequence. So I brought them into clusters to show their morphology, really.
That's great. I also want to ask you that these animals are usually posing like the chicken we saw, or there are horses with beautiful hair. They are looking like real human. Like, how do you manage to pose them? What do you do?
I think with any of us, we're always using multiple tools. Mm-hmm. So I mentioned earlier some of the tools to understand left gaze bias, but there are other tools to understand the way that we work with lines. And so not only am I, in a sense, managing the animal and visualizing what I can then do, but I'm also understanding how I can move the eye through the picture so that you connect the right way around. Notice this, if you look at this picture, the main light source is camera left, because I know that the eye moves this way around the picture. Mm-hmm. And so I use things in a conscious way that allows me perhaps more potential to go to where I can almost work in the subconscious. You know, you sort of do things that you understand logically, that gives you more potential to then, there's always a point where you don't quite understand why things work or don't work, but that I'm using both tools that are used to manage shape, form, and natural tendencies, and marrying that with great animal handlers that can tell me about the animals and what potential shots I could get. So I'm marrying lots of different things together. And then the whole history of art and the history of the medium and how that informs how we think about those pictures.
What I want to bring about the discussion to the thing that with the zoos, what do you think about them? I mean, in modern era, let's say, we usually interact with the animals in zoos, especially the exotic ones, but the zoos are quite problematic. Places as well.
I think that's a very good question, you know, about zoos and, you know, is it, what's ethical? And our relationship with ethics is continually changing. I'd probably argue that wildlife imagery and filmmaking has allowed us to think, well, is it right to keep a gorilla in a zoo? You know, is this sentient being, this being with feelings and emotions, why should it be imprisoned? And I absolutely agree with that. There are lots of other challenges that we face. The zoos are also the places for researchers who are doing research and reintroducing species on trying to save those species where the habitat has been lost. So they do have roles to play that are due with education. But maybe as many zoos, like in London, we had elephants when my mother was a child in the 1930s, she had elephant rides. When I was a child in the 1960s, end of the 60s, I remember seeing tea parties with chimpanzees. These have all long gone. Now it's not appropriate to do that. And I don't think we should be doing that. What I'm saying is everything is changing, ethics and values. Many conservationists will tell you they went to a zoo when they were a child. They were inspired by the animals and they spent the rest of their life wanting to make a difference. So it's hard to know where those demarcations are. I would say that we do have to think, because there are a lot of zoos are there for people who gawk at animals and they're not necessarily educational. Most licenses, certainly in Europe, have to be given only if they're doing conservation, if they're doing education, or they're not allowed to open a zoo. I don't know how it works around the rest of the world, but I think that is a good start. I would also question, is it appropriate to keep animals captively, and that we should be mindful in a way of the broader, how to say, of the issues. And the thing is, we have to connect and communicate and engage people. So I think there is a role for zoos, but I think we have to think how we keep and what we keep in those collections.
I want to ask another question as well. As a photographer, do you think you have a mission to document? Because I think photography is such a documentary tool. Whatever you do, you just document it, first of all, and then you play on it, on the colors or on the some other aspects of it. Do you feel that it's a part of your mission as an artist?
I think that putting myself aside and talking about wildlife photographers, I think they play a very, very important role as educators, as communicators of the science behind the zoology, the whole issues of environmental issues. They are inevitably interpreters often of science into the popular culture. So they have a particular role and they're often the spokesman for those issues. So once you've seen something or witnessed something, it's very hard to unsee that. And once you have an understanding of where we are, then you feel, in a sense, it is a duty. But I would also say, however difficult the issues we are, we're now facing floods, fires, many things in the news today are reminding us that climate change is real and that the insect populations are dropping and that, you know, we came into being because of the extended family, and that if we lose that, we will become lesser. And that, in a sense, it's never been more important to connect people with nature, and that our future depends on it.
I want to ask you my last question, and which is out of photography. What do you think about NFTs? I mean, we are in the age of the digital breakdown, let's say, and the blockchain technology is rising. So what do you think about it? Do you integrate your works into NFTs or?
I haven't, because obviously I've never been though I work in the commercial world to some degree, I would say that I've been driven more by my practice and the bigger question. The NFTs, most of them that have come to light in the press have been inflated and supported or underwritten, you might say, by the creators. But not only that, I think that we are talking in form of capitalism. I'm not sure. Firstly, I don't wholly understand it. I understand that you buy a digital right to something. I worry that many of the examples of huge numbers is, as I say, overwritten or managed by the creators. So let's see how it plays out.
Yeah, it's better to wait and see, I think.
Yeah, but I'm not planning to do any. I would rather try and do something useful and try and produce a hope that tells the stories. But that's not to say there isn't a future in it. I just worry that it's another part of an extended form of capitalism.
Well, that's all for me, I think. And thank you very much for this great conversation and seeing all of your works and all of the technicalities you explain. It's quite interesting, and I think many people find it quite interesting to watch.
It's my honor, so thank you for giving me this opportunity.